When you think of serial killers, you most likely picture a white male. Surprisingly, there have been many female serial killers who have eluded investigators with their demented crimes. Today, we will be looking into 5 cases of shockingly evil female serial killers. Before we jump into our video, please don't forget to stab that subscription button as well as slash that notification bell so you will be notified every single time I post a new true crime video. Our first killer is Clementine Barnabet. Clementine is believed to be born in 1894 in St. Martinsville, Louisiana. She is also believed to be the first African-American serial killer, which is an uncommon occurrence as well. Her parents were Raymond and Nina. She also had 3 brothers. It is reported that Raymond was very abusive to the family, and they moved to Lafayette in 1909. When Clementine was 17 years old, her father, her, and her brother Zephyrin created the Church of Sacrifice. They held the belief that if they killed sinners, they would earn eternal life. Clementine committed her first murder in February 1911. The 3 church members broke into a family's home and bludgeoned a man, his wife, and a child to death with an axe. The church continued with their killings for a year, even crossing state lines. Clementine and her father were arrested in late 1911, but her brother continued to kill for their eternal life. Clementine confessed in 1912. She confessed to her involvement with at least 35 murders. She told police there were many more victims her father and brother killed. She also revealed the existence of the Church of Sacrifice. Clementine received a life sentence in prison, although she was let out in 1918 on good behavior. 6 years after she was released from prison, the X-Men of New Orleans murders started, and many people feel that Clementine may have been the X-Man, but she was nowhere to be found, and they were never able to determine if she did those killings, and they were also never able to determine who the X-Man was, as that is still a cold case to this day. Many years later, there was a death photo circulating around Louisiana, but investigators were not able to link this to Clementine, even though the person looked a lot like her. They were in no way able to say for sure that it was her, and they were in no way able to say that she was the Axeman as well. So Clementine's death and whereabouts after she was released from prison have always been unknown. Our second killer is named Dagmar Overby from Denmark. She was born April 23rd, 1887 in Assendrup. She grew up on a farm and had issues with stealing as a teenager. She was sent away to another family the first time, and for her second theft offense, she was sent to a woman's prison. After she was released from prison, Dagmar worked briefly as a waitress, but she soon fell in love with a man. The two had a baby, and shortly after, the relationship unfortunately crumbled. And soon after that, the baby mysteriously died. The town coroner determined that the cause of death was pneumonia, but all signs pointed to choking or strangulation, including the baby having blue lips and ligature marks on the neck. In 1912, Dagmar met Jens Sorensen Fine and fell in love. She was already pregnant with another man's child, and she put the baby up for adoption to save Jens from embarrassment. She became pregnant again with Jens' baby, and he asked her to get an abortion. She refused an abortion and had a baby boy, although she later left the baby in a haystack and attempted to take her own life when Jens said he would not marry her. Fast forward 3 years, and Dagmar took back her daughter she adopted and moved to Copenhagen. She started her own business to help women adopt out unwanted babies. She was the middleman that would take care of the babies while waiting on a family to adopt them. Dagmar was taking advantage of young women that had babies illegitimately and they were not married. And during this time, abortion was illegal, so they had no other option but to give birth or go through an extremely painful, illegal abortion. And Dagmar promised that she would take care of these babies and find them a loving home, but instead she was murdering them in cold blood. She was discovered by a police report made by Caroline Agason. Caroline could not take care of her baby and left her infant in Dagmar's care. The next day she felt overwhelmed by grief and went back to retrieve her child. Dagmar claimed that the baby had been adopted, although she couldn't remember who adopted them or where they lived. And Caroline became suspicious of this because she only took her baby there the day before. Police found the infant's clothes and discovered that Dagmar had been burning her victims in the oven. They found remains in her cupboard and buried in her backyard as well. Dagmar confessed to killing 16 children, although she was only convicted of 9. Dagmar was given the death penalty, but the monarch at the time, Christian X, did not believe in women receiving the death penalty. Dagmar died in 1929. She was 42 at the time of her death, and she suffered from a dissociative disorder that caused her to have hallucinations and paranoia. Dorothea Puente is our third killer, and she was born January 9th, 1929 in Redlands, California. Her parents were Trudy and Jesse, and her childhood was very traumatic. Both of her parents were alcoholics, and her father often threatened to take his own life in front of their children. He passed away of tuberculosis in 1937, and her mother passed in 1938 in a motorcycle accident. Dorothea was then sent to an orphanage where she was repeatedly sexually abused and treated very poorly for several years. Dorothea was married in 1945 at the age of 16. She married a soldier named Fred McFall. The couple had 2 daughters, but one was sent to live with relatives and the other child was put up for adoption. Fred left Dorothea in 1948 after she suffered from a miscarriage. Dorothea had several failed marriages leading up to about 1982. She would change her name and scam these men, and each marriage only lasted about a year or two. She was a scammer not only to her husbands, but also to other senior citizens. In 1978, she was convicted of cashing 34 federal checks that belonged to her tenants. She was given 4 years probation and had to pay $4,000 in restitution. In April 1982, 61-year-old Ruth Monroe lived with Dorothea in her upstairs apartment. Ruth passed away from an overdose of codeine and acetaminophen. Her death was ruled as a suicide because Dorothea told the police that Ruth was depressed because her husband was terminally ill. Only a couple weeks later, a 74-year-old pensioner named Malcolm McKenzie, who was also one of Dorothea's tenants, accused her of trying to steal from him and also trying to drug him. Dorothea was sentenced to 5 years in prison for this offense. She corresponded with Everson Gilmouth, a 77-year-old retired man from Oregon, while she was in prison. She was released in 1985 after serving 3 of her 5 years and met Everson. The two began wedding planning right away. In November of 1985, Dorothea hired Ismael Flores to install wood paneling in her apartment. She paid him $800 and a red Ford pickup truck. She also asked him to transport a 6-foot box that was nailed shut to a storage depot. She told Ismael that the box contained books, and he ended up dumping the box in an unauthorized household dump site, but the box was later discovered by a fisherman in January 1st of 1986. When police recovered the box out of the dump site, it took them 3 years to determine that the body was her soon-to-be husband, Everson. The police noticed disturbed soil on the property and uncovered 7 bodies. Dorothea was charged with 7 murders, but only convicted of 3, and she ended up passing away on March 27, 2011, and she was 82 years old when she passed away. Our fourth killer is actually a group of women, but I decided to add them to the list anyway because their crimes are especially demented. Maria Delfina, Maria del Carmen, Maria Luisa, and Maria de Jesus Gonzalez Venezuela were 4 sisters who were born between 1912 and 1924 respectively in Mexico. In 1945, the sisters started Rancho El Angel, which was a brothel, but the sisters would drug and kidnap young girls, and when they could no longer perform their services, they would beat them until they died. The sisters would also murder customers that came in with large amounts of cash into the brothel. Police discovered their murders in 1964 because they picked up Josefina Guertes for prostitution. Josefina told police about the Gonzalez sisters and how they are murdering prostitutes and clients at their brothel. Police searched the location and found the bodies of 80 women, 11 men, and several fetuses. Investigators found that the sisters placed help wanted ads for housemaids, and once a young girl would arrive at the brothel looking for work, they were force-fed heroin and cocaine. They were repeatedly sexually assaulted and murdered by the sisters when they could no longer please their clients. Police also found that Maria Delfina and Maria de Jesus were the main murderers. Maria Carmen and Maria Luisa were accomplices. sister was sentenced 40 years in prison. Maria Delfina passed away due to an accident while incarcerated, and Maria Del Jesus was released and never heard from again. Maria Carmen passed away due to cancer, and Maria Luisa became mentally ill while in prison. Our last female killer is Amelia Dyer. She was born in 1836 in Bristol, England, to her parents Samuel and Sarah. Amelia's childhood was very troubling. Her mother developed a mental illness when she contracted typhus, and she often had violent fits and would hurt Amelia, and Amelia was often the one who had to watch her, who had to make sure her mother was okay. And Amelia also had two younger sisters who passed away when she was a little girl. When Amelia was 24 years old, she married 59-year-old George Thoman. She trained to become a nurse and ended up using her own home as a safe haven for women who conceived illegitimate children. Once the child was born, the mother would leave the home and Amelia was to find an adoptive family for the baby, but she would instead let the child die of starvation. As of 1872, Amelia was divorced and remarried and divorced again. She started murdering the babies as soon as the mother left. She later told investigators it was too expensive and inconvenient to let the child die from neglect and starvation, so she decided to murder instead. Amelia was caught and discovered by police in 1879 due to a local doctor finding it suspicious that so many children died under Amelia's care. And during this time, child deaths as well as women's deaths were pretty common. You know, they didn't have so many medical advancements like we do now, so many, many children had to die in order for them to catch her. Police searched her property and found her guilty of neglect, and she only ended up serving 6 months. After her release from prison, Amelia had several stays at a mental clinic due to being suicidal and addicted to opium. She attempted to become a nurse again, but ended up looking after an illegitimate child of a governess. When the woman came back for the child, she immediately knew that the baby that Amelia was caring for was not hers. Her child had a birthmark, and this baby did not. Amelia had a breakdown and again served time in a mental hospital. Until 1896, she continued to murder babies by housing unexpected young women who needed help. Amelia was discovered on March 30th, 1896, because a package was floating in the River Thames by a boat. The package contained the body of a baby girl who was later identified as Helena Fry. Investigators were able to find Amelia's address because she left an address label on the package Helena was wrapped in. Although investigators believed that Amelia had killed up to 400 babies, which would make her the most prolific serial killer of all time, she was only charged with one. She was given the death penalty and hung on June 10th in 1896. Who on this list was the most terrifying to you? If you're interested in a deep dive investigation on any of these killers on this list, or any other ones for that matter, please leave me a comment down below and let me know who you would like me to make a video about. Otherwise, thank you so much for checking out this video, and I hope you all stay safe and be nice to each other. Bye-bye.